welcome to Nordahl Grieg Upper Secondary School, is that right? My name is Tonya, and I'm a teacher at the media department, but I'm also the project manager of Next Level, and that's a project we have in school which have an all-over focus on using games in education. I'm very lucky to be working with these guys, Aleksander and Tobias, because they are really doing all the work. And I'm really excited about today, because I think it's going to be, I think I'm going to benefit from this. And I hope you will as well. I hope you will have a playful day, and that we can have good discussions afterwards and share experiences. So, and I also want to introduce Lynn, who has put together this workshop. So maybe you want to say and introduce our guests for today. Mm-hmm.
Hi. So there's one reason why we're talking in English, and we have an English guest. So I've been so lucky and privileged to be assistant for this research project with Rune Klavia, called Kringsatt, Fiender, which is looking into how to use off-the-shelf computer games in the classroom as, using the games in the classroom, basically. And so we're so lucky in Bergen to have Tobias and Aleksander, who are already doing this at Nordahl Grieg, and it's so exciting to see that work they're doing. Now, parallel to this, I also, in another job, managed to acquire this game-developing genius called James Portnow, who was going to be our game developer in residence for 2.5 months, which happened at the same time that we were organizing this. And so we have James Portnow here for 2.5 months, and I think I've completely worn him out. Which pretty much says exactly how much we need people with expertise here in Bergen as well, because there's so many great projects going on. But we've had a lot of fun with you, and we've learned a lot from you, and I know Tobias and Aleksander are really looking forward to working more with you. But I think with that, I'm going to introduce you as James Portnow, our celebrity on stage.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you all for coming down. I am, as said, a game designer. I've worked on games ranging from the Call of Duty series to Farmville, from League of Legends to stuff by Square Enix, and I run a game design consulting firm. And in that capacity, I have worked for groups from Amplify to Pearson, the textbook manufacturer, trying to figure out how we go about using games in the classroom, because we've all sort of seen that interactivity is the future. And we all also know that today in our classrooms, I mean, 100 years ago, it was hard to get kids to do their homework when the best thing they had to do outside of the school was hit a ball with a stick. And today, our classes have to be as engaging as the internet and modern movies and video games. And so we have to turn to other sources. We have to turn to all these tools we have, because we've spent billions and billions of dollars over the last century learning how to engage a human being, and to leave that just to fill our pastime, to me, that's criminal. But what I really wanted to talk to you guys about today was this idea that you're not crazy for being here. Because I know that many of you probably get some pushback when say to your colleagues or say to other people, I'm going to a workshop on how to use games in education. And so I just wanted to share some of my experiences with games to say, this really works. I've seen this happen a lot. And with that, I wanted to start with, there we go, that button actually changes the thing. Excellent. The simple magic card. I don't know, how many of you guys recognize no magic cards? All right, we got a couple of you. Awesome. Card game I played in my youth. And as a young man, I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life, much less where I wanted to go to college. And I was sitting down and playing this game with my friends. I flipped this card. I don't know if you can really read it from there, but at the bottom of this card, it says, there are some qualities, some incorporate things that have a double life, which thus is made a type of twin entity which springs from matter and light, evinced in solid and shape, Edgar Allan Poe, silence. And that, I mean, it doesn't seem like much, but it was, the language was so much more powerful than anything I had read in my hack fantasy and sci-fi up to that point. You know what I did? I read that, and then later that day, I ran out, and I went to the library, and I got that book. And then after that, I got all the books that they featured quotes from in this game, because it was presented to me in a context that was exciting, that was engaging to me, that I wanted to be more part of. And I have a master's in entertainment technology. I work in games. But I have my bachelor's in classics. I went to college because of the words on this card. And I use that bachelor's. I use that lifelong love of classics that this game instilled in me more every day, both in my professional life as a game designer, but also to keep me centered, to keep me through getting through this world. So this is something that games have given me, something that a simple game outside of even the classroom. Think about how much more could be done with this sort of thing if I had had one of you involved. But there's beyond that, there's so much more. How many of you guys recognize this? We got one or two programmers. All right. So this is the fundamentals of how a computer works. This is the stack. This is how memory management happens to occur. And the interesting thing about it is this is also how one of the mechanics in that card game I just showed you works. They are exactly the same. They were glassed in first out. And I remember the first time I had come into a company and they had asked me, they started to teach me how to script, right? How to write some basic code for a game. And I was talking to one of the programmers, and he explains this to me, and I was like, okay, I got it. Because I've been doing this for 10 years in a game I love. And I could think with these processes better than people had been doing it professionally for a half decade. Because I had been doing it because it was, gave me something I wanted within this game. It gave me an advantage, it gave me power. I've been thinking through this recreationally. This was on my mind, not when I had to be, not when it was assigned to me, but every hour of every day. And so there's so much we can get from these experiences. And some of you may know, besides my work as a game designer, I work a great deal with the US education system. I started a program called Games for Good, where we explore exactly this, what we can do with games. And there's a number of problems that you guys may not have here, but that we encounter all the time in the US that games sort of help us inherently solve, right? The educational system, the fundamentals of the educational system that we brought over from Prussia in the 1850s to the United States was an educational system designed to bring an agrarian society to an industrial society. And it is the best it has ever been at doing that. But that's not what we need anymore. We need to bring an industrial society to our information age future. We need to deal with a world in which we no longer need to memorize our multiplication tables or simply get down the few pieces of data, the few facts you're going to need to be a better clerk or factory worker. Instead, today, we need to provide students with the opportunity to understand how to utilize that data. At their fingertips, in the palms of their hands, on the internet, on Wikipedia, they have access to more raw data than all the aggregated libraries of the 19th century. And so today, the question is, how do you solve problems with that data? And let me tell you, that's what you do in games every day. That is all you do. We give you a set of data, and you apply them to real problems over and over and over again. We have other issues, like feedback time. We have this problem in the United States that we send you a piece of homework, and the students do this piece of homework, and they hand it back to me, and I grade it, and by the time I get it done grading it, it's a week later, and they get a number on top of it, and they probably don't even get a chance to revise it. They just take it, they shove it in their bag. By the time they get it back, they don't know what they did. They don't remember what it was that they were working on. And we've already moved on. They have other homework they have to do. They can't spend a lot of time on this.
And this creates a number of issues. The first one is that it sort of creates this fear of failure. We've told them that, hey, this homework, you get one chance, you better do it right. But that's not how we as human beings learn. We learn by trying, failing, trying again. I watch kids play games all the time. It's a big part of my job. And I see this behavior all the time where a kid will run and dive into a room in a game and try and fight all the monsters at once and lose. But he immediately gets shot back 3 seconds. He's right outside that room again. He can try it again. And this time he runs in and he looks for cover. And he takes that cover position. And then he looks for cover in every other room he ever encounters because he learned it naturally. He learned it for himself. He had a hypothesis. He tested it. It was wrong. He formulated a new hypothesis. And then he tested that one. And when he found that hypothesis held, he tested it against other examples. And as it held across all of them, he applied it to every problem of that nature. That is how we do learn. And so games provide a wide range of things, much larger than we usually think about. I mean, I have seen high-level math taught through World of Warcraft builds. I have seen, at Berkeley, I sat in on an economics course taught through StarCraft. I've seen so many kids lean in and get excited about history through Civilization. I've even seen the dullest of subjects, city planning, made engaging by what we do. And so this is something where don't think of it as limited in scope. There is an application for every type of class within the gaming environment. And if you do, in the end, care about rote memorization, whenever I'm talking at a conference, I do this exercise where I'll have all the people in the audience tell me, I will just ask them, hey, do you guys know 25 Pokemon, 50, 100? And I have people raising their hand at 100. I get to like 200, 300, and I still get a sea of hands up. And think about how much raw data that is that these people memorize. Think about how much they learned because they wanted to. Not because somebody sat them down, not because somebody gave them a test or gave them a lecture, but because they voluntarily did it. Think if those were all vocabulary words in a foreign language, right? This is what we can do. This is what we can do because we have the power to engage. But more than that, sometimes it's the smallest things. And this is the last thing, and then I will turn it over to fellows who are doing excellent work already here in this community and have a lot to provide. But I just want to share one story with you. I was working, I teach whenever I can. I work with a university who has this agreement with me that if I can teach from 8 to 11 p.m., I'll do it. But I was out in California, and I was at a lower-income school district. This is the sort of school district where pregnancy just happened, where you didn't go to college. I had a kid who was in one of my classes, and I wasn't really teaching. I mean, I was just helping out. But this kid, he would tell me that he couldn't do his homework that night because they were hiding in the bathtub because people were shooting outside. And that's the sort of district it was. And I had them playing Mario. And this kid, he runs and he jumps and he falls in a pit. And he runs and jumps, falls in this pit. And he runs and he jumps, he tries something different. And he gets to the other side of the pit. And just this little bit, didn't blow the door wide open, but just it opened up a crack and we started having this conversation about the fact that was his life. He didn't think about cause and effect. He didn't think about consequences. He was living entirely in the moment. He didn't believe he had any agency over his life. And if schools are to instill anything, it's that. And yet in this moment, he could see the cause and effect. He could see the results. And then we could start talking about how, yeah, that was his life, that there was some path that would get him to college. It may not be easy. He may have to readjust continuously. He may have to try harder than he's ever tried in his life. But there was some path. It wasn't all pre-written for him. The place he was born didn't determine his future. And that's also something that games can bring. And so with that, and with those thoughts, I'd like to hand it over to you guys.
Thank you very much, James. So it's kind of difficult to continue from James' inspiring talk, but I will talk a little about my how I got started using games and learning, and I will talk a little bit about some of the principles for learning that we can utilize in games. So when I started out here, this is only my third year teaching at this school and also teaching in general. When I started out here, I pretty soon knew I wanted to use games in my teaching. But I'm not sure where that desire comes from, whether it's an explosion, whether it's some kind of something that I need or desire that's released, or whether it's an implosion that I'm drawn towards something. I'm still not quite sure. But I think my initial inspiration came from my fifth grade school teacher. This is, 18 years ago almost? He was just educated, he was 25, and he was a gamer, like the rest, many guys in my class. So we had, even because he was like almost 15 years older than us, we had this connection with him. So we sat at the computer lab in our school, after school, at Fridays. I didn't think he even told his supervisors, but we sat in this computer lab and we played games. We played Age of Empires, we played Warcraft, we even played Duke Nukem, which I probably shouldn't tell you, even now. We played these games. This was the kind of connection that I hadn't had with any other teacher so far. And this relation that my class got with this teacher was so much tighter and so much intimate than the connection that I had with my other teachers, because we shared this cultural platform together. And so what he used games like Age of Empires as a context for talking about the Neolithic revolution and what happened when we went from a hunter-gatherer society to a agricultural society. He used games like King's Quest to teach us English, because we, you know, after all, you have to understand the text in order to traverse the game. So I think that was my initial, at least he planted the idea in my head that you can actually use games to engage students in a far better way, like James said, intrinsically motivated to learn when using games. And this desire to use games in learning, for my part at least, has only grown. So I've grown for every year I've been working as a teacher. I remember last year me and some colleagues were at the seminar where we talked about the new content in the Norwegian literature and language class. Because, you know, politicians are always iterating on what the Norwegian language is supposed to contain. And there was this author here called Tobias Staaby, who some of you probably know. And she told us that it's the Norwegian teacher's task to teach students the difference between entertainment and art. And I thought to myself, well, so many people view games only as entertainment, only as a pastime. But like James started his speech on, games are more than a pastime. So that's kind of part of my inspiration to, among other things, talk about games in Norwegian language and literature class, because games are more than a pastime, and they are more than entertainment. So I was kind of strict with some of my colleagues this last Friday when I talked about, there was this planning day in Hordaland for all, and there was this course for all Norwegian teachers to come and listen to various people talk about the Norwegian language and literature class in various contexts. So I talked about games. I told these people who have so much more experience than I have, I was kind of strict and kind of firm with them. I said, as curators of culture, it's actually our duty to start talking about this within the context of school. And I think that actually struck a nerve with some people, because after the my seminar, after my course, I got a bunch of people coming up to me with kind of mildly desperate eyes and asked me, when do I start? Where do I start? So I think at least on that day, I inspired some Norwegian teachers to start using games and talking about games in their class. There's also another guy at this seminar I was on last year when we talked about the new content of the Norwegian language, Norwegian subject. And he said that people have the right to know where they come from. And I thought, I don't only come from Ibsen and Camilla Collett, I come from Dungeons and Dragons, I come from Tolkien, I come from Super Mario, I come from all these other things that I know other students also come from, like their background. So that there is so many reasons that we as teachers have to start talking about video games, not only as a teaching tool, but also as a cultural form of expression. So like I said, my fifth grade school teacher used Age of Empires as a context in history. He used to as serving as a context for discussion in history. he used King's Quest V as a motivation for us to start actually reading, like really close reading of the text, because many of the texts we read otherwise in English just didn't really, at least for us boys, didn't really inspire us to like actually read this closely. But in order to traverse into King's Quest, you actually had to pay attention. You had to really, really read the text, you know, and understand it in order to progress through the game. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the learning principles that I have used and my colleagues have used in our when we work with games in class. John Shapiro, who writes for Forbes and he also teaches philosophy and classical literature, he talks about something he calls scaffolding for emptiness. And he starts every class that he teaches, he starts every class that, telling his students that they will learn nothing. They will learn nothing. And with what he means by that is he says to his students, he says they will learn no thing. They will not learn bullet points. They will not learn kind of isolated entities of knowledge. What they will learn is actual skills and new ways of thinking. So what John Shapiro says that games can do is create this scaffolding that's filled with nothing, but in which the students can fill with knowledge and with reflections on the course material, and actually use how you can use games to create this scaffolding in which the students can construct their knowledge and to construct their skills. And what we can do in school, my seminar, my workshop for today is that you can use games like, for instance, The Walking Dead, which contains really nothing. It contains no bullet points on the course in ethics that I use it in. But it contains this scaffolding, or this context, if you will, that you can use to fill and construct your knowledge on how to argue using ethical theories and moral philosophy. John Shapiro also talks about how games are really good at exchanging different signifiers in a system. He talks about, for instance, how Call of Duty and Space Invaders is basically about the same thing, but it's just the signifiers that are exchanged. And he talks about how Dragon Box uses this very effectively, because many of you have probably tried Dragon Box, and it contains initially no numbers and no letters. It's just these abstract symbols that you have to balance out. But what this does, it secretly teaches algebra. And the creators of Dragon Box explained how just in 42 minutes, even a kindergartner can grasp the basic concepts of algebra. Because what the game does is it gradually exchanges out these abstract symbols for actual symbols, actual numbers, and actual letters. So after 45 minutes, the game kind of looks like this. After 1 hour, you see how the complexity grows and grows. Where after 4 hours, you are basically solving equations with unknown factors. And this is just after 4 hours. And this, John Shapiro makes a point out of how if you just exchange signifiers within the context of a video game, you can teach quite complex things just using video games, because like James said, you are encouraged to retry and reiterate and try out different approaches, whereas otherwise in school, if you fail, then that's it. So in interest of keeping on time, I will talk a little bit about another gentleman that has inspired me greatly. This is James Portnow, and he has written a book that he calls What Video Games Have to Teach Us About Learning and Literacy. So in this book, he explains on how video games are really, really good at teaching the player how to play the game and teaching the player skills that the player needs to traverse the game. And what he writes about something he calls situated embodied learning. Well, because he explains that if you only know something verbally, if you only know the lexical definition of something, then you really don't know anything. You haven't really learned anything. Because if true learning is going to take place, you need to put your abstract knowledge into actual context. You have to put it in situations that you can actually employ what you learn. So he says, if you only know the dictionary definition of democracy, but you can't recognize what the democracy is, then you really don't know what democracy is. So in the same way, if if you don't know what utilitarianism is, or if you don't know what counter-categorical imperative is, then if you can utilize in the way you argue and the way you talk, then you haven't really learned it. So if we want our students to actually learn these abstract concepts that we all will teach them, we have to create a context where they can actually employ these different concepts. So for instance, what I did, I used Walking Dead as a context for ethical discussion. So when I teach my students about ethics of consequence and of Jim Bentham's utilitarianism and Aristotle's ethics of virtue, I use the game as a way for my students to actually create meaningful situations for my students to employ and use this new concept that I teach them. And since the actions you take in the Walking Dead actually affect the story of the game, then they have completely different motivations for discussing and using these concepts that I teach them. And what James Bulgeet means when he talks about embodied learning is that he understands the mind as an extension of the body. So you actually use your mind, in an active way when you learn something, instead of just writing the definitions on a test that you get handed back to you with a grade or with a letter or with a number, then you haven't actually learned anything. But when you can use this as a foundation on when you discuss a situation ethically, then we can actually start about real teaching and real knowledge and real learning taking place. So this is just a few of the ways that we can use games as a context for teaching. Because games are interactive, they encourage completely different ways of learning, completely different ways of creating knowledge. Because games, they talk back to you. They actually give you feedback on what you do. Drawing your box gives you feedback on how you're doing. When you create farms in Age of Empires, then you can actually see how the way you play the game changes, the same way that society changes when you go from hunter-gatherer society to agricultural society. So, with that, I think I'll actually give the microphone to Aleksander. So this is what I'll be talking about in my workshop later on, at least. Yes.
All right, thank you very much, Tobias. Thank you very much, James. Now, James, I hope, has inspired you guys to want to use games in your classroom. Tobias has talked about some of the principles that you should be aware of when you want to use games in your classrooms. Now, what I'm going to be looking into a little bit is, okay, you guys want to use games in your classrooms, you guys want to use games in your school. I suppose that's the reason that you're here today. That is the reason that you're here today, is it? Yeah, nodding heads, good. That was what I was looking for. So, I'm expecting this to be you. I want to start using games in school. Just a quick raise of hands. For how many of you does that quote resonate? For how many of you is this the reason that you're here today? Raise your hands, please. Oh, I'm very glad. I'm very glad. I've been worried that maybe this was just, there's a conference, free lunch, coffee, awesome. I'm very glad this is why you're here. Now, I'm going to be talking a little bit about what we have done here at Nolgreig, and I'm going to be talking a little bit about where I or you should start when you want to use games in your classrooms. In the workshops that we're going to be holding a bit later today, you guys are going to be supplied with several practical examples. But what we want you guys to take away from this day is not just the games that we've used, the games that we know, the methods that we know. What we want you guys to be able or to want to do when you leave here today is to
find games that you like, find out, okay, how can this apply? How can this apply to my classroom? How can I design a lesson unit using this game to better allow my students to learn? So we've been using games here at Nordic for about 3 years now. Some of the games that we've been using, you can see here, Civilization 4, Minecraft, we've been doing some stuff with, a game called Dear Esther, Portal 2, some more recent examples, Skyrim, Gone Home, which my workshop is about later on today, which I'm actually using in English right now. Awesome game. The Walking Dead, which Tobias's workshop is going to be about. And we have a whole lot more planned. We're just now getting started using games in the classroom. We want to do more of this, and we also sincerely hope that a lot more of this will be done in other schools, both here in Hordaland and in the rest of Norway as a whole. Now, organizing a game-centered unit. The medium, the games medium, is probably fairly new to most classrooms. However, even though the games medium itself might be new, the way you organize your lessons, the way you organize your teaching, the way you organize learning doesn't have to be all that different. Doesn't have to be all that different from what you are already doing. I expect all of you guys are awesome teachers, or those of you who are teachers at least, I expect that you guys are all awesome teachers. You know your pedagogy, you know your didactics. And when you're using games in school, you use the exactly same skill set that you're already using, just with the addition of a new medium that does bring something new into the classroom. But still, this isn't magic that we're bringing into the classroom. We're not bringing in something uniquely, fantastically different from everything else that will completely revolutionize, that will completely change your classroom. But we are adding in a bit of extra value. Now, I've got here just a few tips and tricks when getting started organizing a game-centered unit, or any unit where you plan to use games as a component. First off, don't expect your students to be computer game experts. Now, many of your students might be computer game experts, but be aware when introducing a game, to class. You will probably need to spend quite a bit more time learning the mechanics of the game. And this is time that, say you were using a book, say you were using a film, that you would not have to spend. Students don't require a massive skill set in order to sit down here in this auditorium to watch a film. Students have read books, throughout their entire time in school. But far from all students will have played games to any extent. So you need to figure out how much time can you justify spending to learn game mechanics. And this will depend. Now, what kind of a unit are you running? What are the intended learning aims? Which subjects will you be covering? There are a lot of games out there that really, really well demonstrate a whole lot of different concepts that can be really, really interesting to cover in a classroom. But in order to get to these concepts, you need to be aware that depending on your choice of game, you might be spending a whole lot of time learning game mechanics. So in order to justify the time spent learning game mechanics, very often what you can do is try to collaborate with other teachers. Once you've identified a game that's good for your subject, talk to your colleagues. Find out, is this something that can be applied to other teachers' classes as well? And if it is, that means you can justify that much more time learning the game mechanics and learning the game mechanics and thereby get a greater benefit in the end. And as I said earlier, games aren't magically different. At least that's my take on it. Games aren't magically different from novels or short stories or films or textbooks or anything like that. Apply similar didactic approaches when using games as you would using other tools. As with any lesson plan you make, be aware of what you might want your students to learn. Make a plan. This part should be obvious. But one of those things that I find using games that's nearly equally as important as having a clear plan for what you want with your game unit is leave room for unintended learning. Unlike using a book, unlike watching a film, a computer game is, by its very nature, non-linear. If I'm reading a novel together with my class, and they've reached page 50, I might know that something really, really, really interesting is happening on page 51. When they're playing a game, these points in time when they get to these areas that are really, really, really interesting, or that provide these very insights that I want my students to be exposed to, I as a teacher don't have the same level of control for at what point will this very very this very very interesting point be reached. So you need to leave room for students experiencing things in different order, and also that they might make insights that you hadn't planned in the first place, and when they do, run with it. And also, and this I've found is a very, very important message to impart in my students. Now, mastering the game is not your main objective. This is a Gary Larson strip. I think this is from, this cartoon was drawn in the early 1990s. Can you guys read the text in here? Yeah, well, anyway, what you're seeing here is this kid playing his video game, and playing a video game, and you have his parents back there dreaming away about wanted ads in the faraway future, which was 2005. So this is a pretty old cartoon. Nintendo expert needed. $50,000 salary plus bonus, equal opportunity employer. Looking for good Mario Brothers player. $100,000 plus your own car, etc. Now, when we're using games in our classroom, these kinds of objective that these parents here are dreaming of. This isn't what we're hoping for our students. We need to be aware of ourselves, and as importantly, we need to make our students aware that of what are the learning objectives. What is the purpose of using the game? Let's see. I've almost spent all my time already, but I just quickly want to show you guys how such a lesson unit can be organized. Now, I've been using the game Civilization 4 now for 3 years in English, social science, and Norwegian classes. This is a four-week-long project, and Norwegian, English, and social science put all together, that's 12 classes per week. Now, when we're using games in class, games isn't the only thing we're doing. In much the same ways when we use any other media in class. When you're reading a novel, you don't only read the novel. There are a series of other activities that one does as well. Same goes for film, and same, of course, should go for video games. So, when we ran this unit, we spent about 30 to 40% of our time on active playtime. We did other things like teacher presentations, reflection tasks, group discussions, and blog writing. So, the message that I want to give from this is that when people like me and Tobias, who are really, really dead set that using games is an awesome, awesome, brilliant idea, when we're talking about games, we're not talking about, we're not saying that games should replace everything else. We're saying that games, we're saying that games is an excellent, excellent addition to all the content that we have in school already. And I think that means my time is about up. We'll be talking a lot more about practical examples later on in the workshops, and also at the end of the day, we're going to be showing you guys we're going to be showing you guys several games that with fairly little effort can be implemented in your classrooms. Yeah. So I think I'll give the mic to Lynn now. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you. I'm very excited. So when we were talking about the program, Tobias and Aleksander, of course, all of us want to hear from them. But one of the things that we talked about was that maybe it'd be interesting to get a game developer to come talk about exactly how they use these thoughts on creating games. I mean, what exactly do they think about when it comes to narrative and game mechanics and so on? How do they design a game and think about it? You start setting up with? And so, luckily, we have a lot of game developers in Norway that we can choose from. But we talked about the different ones, and one of the ones that we became very fascinated with was the game Among the Sleep, which is created by a studio called Krillbite. And the reason why we got fascinated by them is because they've created this game that you have to get the perspective of a toddler. And so they put a lot of thoughts into what kind of game design went into giving you that impression that you actually are a toddler, that you're a little baby and you have to move around and everything. And I'd already heard a few presentations, so it was a privilege to ask Ole Andreas, who is the CEO of Krillbite. Yeah? It is CEO you are, right?
Yeah, I don't usually call myself CEO, but I'm head.
Head of doing administrative stuff. I think we're going to call you the CEO now. But so it's a real honor to present Ole Andreas, and he's going to talk a little bit about Among the Sleep and behind the scenes, maybe. Yep. So please, yeah.
Thank you. So, the text in the presentation is in Norwegian, is James there now? Should I talk in English or Norwegian?
I think he moved up.
Ah, there
I
you
would love to hear this presentation.
Yeah.
You'll just explain the slides to me later.
Cool, sure. Okay, so what I wanted to talk about is some of the thoughts we put into making our game, because we had a really unique challenge, we thought, because we did a concept of a game where you're playing as a two-year-old in a horror adventure setting, but the unique thing is that you're playing a two-year-old, and we've never seen that in a game before. This gave us a lot of unique challenges and an opportunity to learn about how to make that fit into a game, I'll discuss it more later. So this is us. We are 9 people situated in Hamar. We are 9 people that went to the same school, worked together on a bachelor thesis, and extended that relationship and dove into it with creating a company structure and making this a full-time job. We are part of a network of game developers in Hamar, and we have released 2 games. The one I'm not going to be talking about today is The Plan, but it's also a unique concept, I think, because in this game you play as a fly. It's a really short game and it's free, and I invite you to try it out. It's available on our website, krillbite.com, and you can just download it and try it. It's 10 minutes and might be worth your time. So this is the game, and this is our toddler, and we started out with some core thoughts on the game. So these are screenshots from the game. I don't know if you can see them. It's quite bright in here. But it kind of represents the sense of immersion that we wanted. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Because we wanted the player to be able to experience this from a first person view of the plan. Ah, that's better. So we wanted the player to be able to experience that from this view and be able to take control, like get into the role of being a two-year-old. So immersion was a big thing for us. And as we started like diving into what is immersion, what makes immersion in a game, there was a lot of stuff to learn, because we are game developers, and we've been trained in the skills of making a game, like programming and art and sound design and all that. But we have never done any research on how a two-year-old thinks, and at least not how immersion works in theory. So we had to start reading up on a lot of theory about how to create immersion, and luckily there's a lot of research around it already from game developers. And there's two persons, one called Stefan Björk and Jussi Holopainen, who writes in the patterns of game design and divide immersion into four categories, and these are four categories. And the game we wanted to make would have to explore these four stages. So everybody knows this, right? This is the typical non-player trying to be immersed in the game, and I think it's somewhat iconic of how that works, like immersion, because she there thinks that if she leans to the side, that will actually make the player or the car or what she's driving go to the side. And I think that is a good example of how immersion how you might extend on that, maybe. And another game we've taken a lot of inspiration from when it comes to immersion is Bioshock. It's a game where the player sets, the setting is you're deep beneath the ocean in an underwater city. And what the player does is he explores the city through narrative, through finding, exploring and finding hints about what has happened and how this city was built and why it was built. And it's a really good example of immersion that tries to, it creates a full universe that the player can explore in his own pace and his own way. So for our game, the earliest meetings we had, we kind of discussed what the core points would be for the game and how we would achieve this immersion that we wanted to have. The main things we wanted to have was we thought that we had to have a physical body. So as you look down in the game, you would have to see your body, so you're connected and not just like feel that the camera has been lowered further down to the ground. So we thought that was really important. And that brought a lot of new other challenges, like how does a toddler move? How does a two-year-old move? What is he capable of physically? And what are a familiar environment for a toddler? Because a toddler has probably not experienced a lot, so we have to keep it within familiar environment. I don't think we managed to like do that in the full game, but that was the earlier like thoughts on it. And underdeveloped understanding of realism or reality, that like it expanded to be one of the core things, like the core themes of the game. So as we started developing this game, that was maybe the most important point for us during the entire development, because we thought that was maybe the most exciting point to explore on how a two-year-old's mind work and his cognitive, like what stage he is cognitive, how much can he understand. And I'm gonna show you a video at the end that I think it's so powerful, and it kind of spoils the game, but it shows what the game tries to, and how the game tries to achieve the same thing. And physical restrictions. So what kind of physical restrictions do a child have? Can't lift like heavy objects and move them around. So we have to make that as realistic as possible, without breaking the game feel of like the flow of the game. So it can't be too restrictive, so it feels like you can't do anything, because I guess a two-year-old or a three-year-old or a toddler can't do much. And we wanted to have a teddy, because it's funny how like objects like a teddy bear can mean that much to a child. And that's something we wanted to explore, and how that could amplify the immersion and amplify the feeling of being a child. So, and the setting was pretty set. We wanted a horror game, an adventure game, but not the kind of jump scare horror. We wanted a horror game where you were exploring and more of a creepy, atmospheric kind of setting. And a game where you explore a narrative through the two-year-old point of view, and how the player can feel, can have empathy for the child and the setting he's in. That was one of the core things we wanted to explore. So we started looking out for I think there's some. Does the sound work? That would be awesome. Two seconds. Yeah, I don't think it works. Oh well, if you can figure it out while I play this video, it's great. So we started looking out on the internet for inspiration and for material data to work on, and we found a video of a father that put a GoPro camera or like a small camera on top of his two-year-old, and had him play hide and seek with him. So this is the father playing hide and seek with his child, like 2-3 year old. The interesting thing about how this, like, what we thought was most interesting about how this works is that the child, he just seemed to have a restricted sense of abstract thinking. Like, If the father was hiding in the closet the last time, he will probably look in the closet the next time as well, because he can't understand how anything else can exist, basically. So,
is it possible for me to pause this real quick?
Yeah, sure. So the child is basically running around and trying to look in the same places that he looked last time. And it's also a great video for us to explore how the movement is, how the camera feels, how the view feels, basically. Thank you so much. Really awesome to see, like how the child. You can almost see what he thinks. You can almost like understand what the child is thinking. And it's awesome that he made this like just about when we started to making the game. So, and I thought that was awesome to be able to explore, like how a human person starts developing at an early age. So we use that actually like inspiration from that video with how we think when creating a level of the game. So when the child wakes up, what is his first thought? Like, where does it go? Where would the natural place be to go? So we designed the level so that he would walk So the path to the parents' bedroom would feel as obvious as possible. And we tried to enforce that, like that the player wanted to go there. We also wanted, like, if we could create the sense of immersion that the player actually felt like he acted on the role he was playing, that would be awesome. That would be like our main priority. And also, since the kid has underdeveloped sense of reality, we could use that in really well in our horror setting to ground why we did some design choices. For example, seeing things, objects in the dark that you can't explain what is, you could actually now explain that the child actually didn't have anything to. I guess that might be why we were more scared as children, because when we walked down the basement stairs, we didn't know what was in the dark. But as we grew older and took the chance to go there and explore and saw that there was nothing there, and continuously explored and continuously enforced that that reality that there is nothing there, we learned that it's safe, and we wanted to ground the horror setting in that the child hasn't experienced. A child hasn't experienced this before.
Whoa! Oh wow!
ready? Oh! Face plant. Oh, wow. This is amazing. I can walk and stand up and walk. And I waddle like a penguin. And I can crawl, too. I want to crawl. Oh, I got the hands and everything. This is amazing. Can I pick any of this up? Oh, my God, I pick it up. Horsey!
So we wanted to create that space of, like, that room, that space for the player to feel as a child and be able to really dive into the role before we started moving him forward. So that was important for us to take time.
Monster!
Some more videos.
Mama, wake the fuck up! Mama! 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 No! Oh! Whoa, whoa, whoa! I'm a baby! I'm a baby! Panic! Don't panic! Don't panic! Don't panic! Don't panic! Whatever you do, don't... That way, hide under the bed. Hide under the bed. Oh, snap!
So, seeing that players put videos of them and seeing that they actually, like, they took part in the role, it's really rewarding and you feel like you've accomplished what you tried.
I left this open! That's my bottle! Damn it! What? What? I don't know what that says. Close the fridge. All of our food is spoiled now. I need that shit to eat. Can I open cup?
That's also examples of that. And that was one of our, like, core goals. And he couldn't read what was written there. So he created an entire alphabet of just scribbles. So the player can't actually read anything in the game. Just to enforce that sense of immersion.
Oh God, do I want to open the door? Oh, I see. So I have to move the chair to there. Good, I like how that works actually. Okay.
And having the chair and player actually have to, like, we removed the jump functionality, which is like a default thing for a lot of games. Please let me know when I'm bad on time. So we removed the jump functionality because we thought that actually broke the sense of immersion in the game. So, and that, like, led to a lot of interesting ways of exploring how you would have to navigate the world to actually be able to continue. For example, like pulling a stool into the door and climbing that stool to be able to reach the door handle because the door is locked. Which is not something that a game with a normal sized human being would have to do. And this is an example of how fast immersion could be broken in a game where you put that much energy into creating that space.
It's fine. I'm just a baby. They couldn't possibly kill a baby, could they? Step aside, chair. Oh, jab! Lot of fun! I don't know what happened, but it scared the fuck out of me. Must push! All right, Gandalf, it's you and me. And Teddy. Oh, hell no! I'm going baby mode. Gandalf! No! No, come back! He went through the floor! No! Ah, fuck it.
So that's an example of, like, just a small glitch like that could be able to break the immersion. There's a lot of other videos here about the same thing. We also tried to explore a lot of other things during the development to be able to extend on the immersion. And one thing was physical interaction, like actually holding things in the hand and having IK, like the hands actually grabbing things and reacting physically correct. But you have always, like, when creating games, there's always limitations that you have to consider, and you can't
this was an early prototype, so it looks pretty lousy, but the thought was this. But like creating a game, you have limitations that you have to follow and a budget that you have to follow. So some things has to be cut, and you can't create a simulator for everything. And it's a game, but it's within those limitations, you try to explore the subject as much as you can. And we're also been exploring with Oculus Rift, using Oculus Rift, which is a VR headset. I don't know how many have heard of it, but it's... All right, thanks. It's one of the things that I think could extend on the immersion even more, because now you can actually, instead of looking at a flat screen in front of you, you can actually be part of that world. And I've seen a lot of ways that VR can be used, and I think it hasn't reached like 10% of its potential yet. I think there's a lot of ways that we can use VR to help create the sense of immersion and experiences that we can't do now. And maybe in learning as well, VR can be used to like remove the border between the person experiencing and the game itself. I'm not sure what this is. Yes, early prototype showing tests of doing IK on the hands, like actual movements. This was cut from the game. A really interesting point to explore, and I believe it would work really well, but it would require too much work for us to be able to make it. And sound was really important for us in creating the immersion. It wouldn't be possible to create a space for the player to lose himself in if it wasn't for sound. And probably should there should be a separate lecture or talk about using sound for creating immersion. But yeah, we hired a sound guy pretty early on, and I think that 78% of creating a space or a place to explore has to do with sound. So sound is really important. And we had some challenges with the game and trying to create a right balance before the player got thrown out of the experience. And camera wobbling was one of them, like how, to which extent can we implement it? As you saw in the camera on the two-year-old, he was wobbling pretty much a lot. He probably didn't look as extreme from his point of view, but still it's more extreme than you can do in a game because you're not physically experiencing the movement. But we wanted to keep, like, still create that sense of waddling like a two-year-old. That was a challenge we had to balance, right? And another challenge while playing a game like this, which relies a lot on exploration and immersion, is you need to have the player in a correct setting and correct mood to be able to create that sense of immersion. So he has to play in a, like preferably he would play it in a dark room with headsets on and just block everything out. And I guess that's true for a lot of games. They have to be played in the correct setting to be enjoyed to the full. And a build-up. We needed a good build-up because this game had a narrative which was really important to the game, and we had to be sure that the player understood what he had to understand before we continued the story or the building narrative of the game. and I talked a little bit about Oculus Rift, and I think that's something that can be really important in the future, and we tried to implement it into our game with partial success. I think that it has a lot of problems with just adapting it to games that we know today, because what it really requires to have that immersion is you as a player, or physically, you have to believe that you're doing the same as what you're seeing on the screen. So, but what I thought was one of the most important points that we had to work, that we had to explore, was the underdeveloped understanding of reality. That's one of the most, like, I really think that's one of the most important things we can do in games. We can, a game today can be so much more than just Tetris or Space Invaders or just core, like playing gameplay, Farmville or whatever. It can explore subjects, it can explore thematics that, like The Walking Dead, it explores how a human mind, like how you as a human can, how you can actually, it can put you in a situation that you would never experience in your real life, and present to you choices that you would never have to take and test and see what kind of choices you would take. And I can really understand how that could be used in an ethics class, because it's, there are some really, really extreme cases of choice there. That I've played The Walking Dead, and I've stood there after taking one choice and wondered how did I get here? And it, I guess it's the same with real life. You end up doing choices with the information you have at that point, and you just have to make that choice and live with that and experience that consequence. And it's great that a game can present you with extreme cases so you don't have to experience it or do it in real life. I saw this class at, I think it was Harvard, on YouTube. I think it was Harvard on YouTube, yeah. And he that was actually an ethics class. And he presented a choice, like, I think there was a rolling cart towards a person that stood on the track, and you had a button that would be able to derail that cart and save that person, but I would kill that person in that cart, and what that choice would mean. And with games, you can actually present that in a way that doesn't give you more time than just a fraction of a second, as it would in real life, and you would feel the situation on you. And that's what Walking Dead does well, I think. And what we tried to deal with in Among the Sleep thematically is how a child would perceive a broken family, like a broken home. A family where the mother might be an alcoholic, and where the father might not have been around much. And we wanted to explore how a child could or would perceive a situation like that, how that could affect the child. We thought that was really, really interesting. And I wanted to show you a video that was made, and was released a month ago, I think. And it's really cool how that, I think it tries to do the same as the game. And I guess that's what the core thing ended up with us trying to explore about, like around among sleep. That was the core thing we wanted to explore around, more around. And just exploring how much it impacts a child, even at that early age, like 2 years old. Like when you're 2 years, you start developing some kind of not long-term memory maybe, but still there develops like patterns of your experiences that will imprint on your life and will like stay with you for the entire life. And I think that's the strength of games today. And that's the games that we in Krillbite want to make. And I think that's the sort of games that could be brought into maybe into education and talked about in classes like ethics class. Yeah, that's me. Yes. Yep. Any questions?
Okay, I'm just gonna try this out.
I'll be around anyways if people have questions later.
Well, I have a question for you.
All right.
Do you hear me?
And the Norwegian is a lot better than my English.
Thank you, Olanas. One of the things that I was wondering before I'll open up the questions to everybody else is as a game designer, you mentioned it a little bit in your presentation. What are your thoughts about teaching the player? Because as a game designer, that's what you're constantly doing, isn't it? It's teaching the player about the environment and or teaching what they're supposed to be doing next. And I don't know, I'd like for you to talk a little bit about that. I mean, what are your thoughts about it?
Yeah, I think games are, they are probably a really, really good case for that. Like, just, I guess James talked a lot about it in his presentation, but that in our game, for example, you have to like understand the premise before you can go on. So we have to like introduce the player to how the player feels, like who you are. You wake up. Well, that game actually starts off as you sitting on your little baby stool, my baby chair, and putting down the glass that you're holding up in front of your face, and throwing it on the floor. That's how the game starts. And you got some physical objects in front of you that you can pick up and move around. So we try to introduce the player to what the setting is, who the character is, before he tries to do anything more in the game. And I guess that's the basic of teaching or basic of learning. You can't start in the middle of a big curriculum. You can't start in the middle of, you have to understand the basics before you can move on. And a game forces you to do that every time. And in every setting, you'll be taught the basics first. And then you have to understand the basics. A lot of games do this really well, and a lot of games don't do it as well. I think we managed to do it okay for our first game, but we learned a lot about it. And a lot of games today try to do something I really like, is that they try to, because I see the problem with curriculum, for example, today, is that if you missed anything on the earlier days in school, a lot of people fall off when you're introduced to more advanced stuff. But a lot of games today has the same problem. if you never played games before, you won't be familiar with a first-person controller or first-person shooter or whatever. That's not familiar. Like, you haven't learned the basics. But a lot of games today tries to introduce new ways of controlling and new ways of experiencing a game that tries to go back to, like, teaching the basics of a game. And The Walking Dead is not a good example of that, I think. It doesn't, like, involve advanced control schemes or advanced ways of controlling it. And the game has, games like that has become more about teaching, or it's more about, like, the other, it tries to discuss other stuff than how to play it. Well, so I don't know what the, like, how to answer that, but I think that going back to the basics and understanding, yeah, I don't know what I'm talking about, but it's basic learning, right? It's you have to make sure the player understands one thing before you move on to the next. And a game called Super Meat Boy did that really well. I think that's a good example of a game that does teaching well, because it teaches you to do one thing, and then when you have understood that and you have repeated that enough times, it teaches you to another thing. And then when you understand that, understood that again, it teaches you to apply those together. And that's what I think, like, the core strength of games lies. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Hi, great presentation. And I was wondering, do game designers read learning theory, or do you feel your work is based more on intuition of how you want the player to perceive it?
I think every game designer should read about learning like theory. I think every game designer should know the basics of learning. That's like, I guess that's the core thing about every game, how it's designed, but I think it's a blend between both, because you have to use intuition, and you have to try something new, and you have to, like, either fail or succeed and do it again. So I think it's a bit of both, but a basic understanding of learning and how a human works, I think a basic in psychology would be great. I would love to do a bachelor's degree in psychology or something, just to understand more about how the brain actually works.
Anybody else?
So the thing to know about games is, the answer is yes. Good game designers study everything, but things like learning theory, every game is an act of teaching. As a human being, I don't walk around by moving two sticks with my thumb, right? Every single game, I have to teach my player a number of different and totally non-intuitive things, and so as such, yes, we go study learning theory a great deal, because this is the most important part of your game. If we cannot communicate those basic things, if we cannot teach a player how to have an experience that is unlike anything they've had in this real world, then our game falls apart.
Good.
Yeah. I have another question for you.
Yeah.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about playtesting I guess I'm going to lead you into one of my favorite stories about Among the Sleep and your playtesting, and it was about somebody trying to get down from the bed
and was thinking like they were a toddler or that they need to be more careful about going down from the bed. But if you could talk a little bit about how you use playtesting to get better and that story, of course.
Yeah, I have a video of, I'm not sure where it is. Just gonna try. Okay, so I don't have that video. But okay, so the case she's talking about is that one player was standing on top of some drawers that he had pulled out, and on his way down, instead of just jumping down, which would make like a small little sound, or like a child not liking this sound, and he actually like took out the drawers to be able to walk down safely, and even though it wouldn't like hurt him to jump down, he took that act just because he wanted to. Yeah, I guess he immersed himself in the game. But playtesting is maybe the most important part of making a game, and I guess it should be the most important part of making anything. Because from playtesting, you're able to test your hypothesis, you're able to test what you're trying to achieve, and get feedback on if it doesn't work or not. And you can improve on that, and that's the basics of learning, because you have to learn how to make your game while developing it. You're not going to make the perfect game the first time. And I'm guessing that's something that might apply to a lot of other things as well. So asking for feedback and doing playtesting and observing how people or your players or your the persons experiencing what you made, how they perceive it, how they engage it, how they solve it, it makes you able to make that a better experience for the final product. So most important thing of making a game is the playtesting, I think.
Anybody else? Okay.
So we're breaking up for lunch. Lunch will be served at 11:45, and it's a room right behind here.
Yeah.
Does it have a name?
Yeah, it's 236.
236.
Yeah.
And then it's lunch for 45 minutes, and then there's workshops, but we'll inform you during the lunch of where to go and how the workshops are going to be organized. Okay, thank you.